that Jerusalem is Israel's capital.
特朗普宣布承认耶路撒冷为以色列首都，一时激起千层浪。
How do you understand his decision?
Decide on your own. Who are you?
巴以局势平添变数，和谈进程何以为继？
If you really want a two-state solution, you have to recognize the state of Palestine. The United States never recognized the state of Palestine.
对话巴以和谈亲历者，巴勒斯坦史上首位外交部长纳比勒·沙阿斯，走进巴以乱局。纳比勒·沙阿斯出生于1938年，是巴勒斯坦历史上首位外交部长。从阿拉法特时代到如今的阿巴斯执政时期，其个人的从政经历与巴勒斯坦的建国进程环环相扣。而作为资深外交官，他亲历了半个多世纪以来巴勒斯坦与以色列之间冲突与和谈的整个过程。可以说，纳比勒·沙阿斯是一部记录了巴以关系进程的活历史。
Good afternoon, Dr. Shaath.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to our program. So I see that you were the Minister of Planning and International Cooperation of Palestine in 1994. And in 2003, you became the first ever Foreign Minister of Palestine. Why is there a change of role in the year 2003?
There was no change in the role. There was a change in the title. Because in 1994, the Americans protested to Yasser Arafat then using the name Minister of Foreign Affairs. They said this is a title that only a state, a fully independent, recognized state can use. So the Israelis will not accept it and they will make a problem about it. So, President Arafat asked me, choose a title for yourself. So I chose Planning and International Cooperation.
But in 2003, when you decided to change the title, okay. Did they object?
When Abu Mazen, our president, became prime minister to Yasser Arafat, he said, let's challenge the Americans and tell them that you are, in effect, our foreign minister. You are in charge of all our embassies. You are in charge. You meet all the ambassadors here. You meet heads of state everywhere. So everybody knows that you are really a foreign minister and the name. And it passed.
Today we finally acknowledge the obvious, that Jerusalem is Israel's capital.
2017年12月6日，美国总统特朗普宣布承认耶路撒冷为以色列首都，并将启动美驻以使馆从特拉维夫前往耶路撒冷的进程。以色列总理内塔尼亚胡称
：“President Trump, thank you for today's historic decision to recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital. The Jewish people and the Jewish state will be forever grateful.”
而巴勒斯坦则是另一番景象。成千上万愤怒的民众涌上街头，举行了为期3天的全国游行示威，期间造成7人死亡。同时，国际社会纷纷给予警告，指出美国的相关举动将一手摧毁目前得来不易的巴以和谈进展。2017年12月18日，联合国安理会就反对美国承认耶路撒冷为以色列首都的草案进行表决，14个安理会成员国投赞成票，但被美国一票否决。3天后，联合国大会召开紧急会议，以压倒性多数票通过决议，认定任何宣称改变耶路撒冷地位的决定和行动无效，必须予以撤销，并强调耶路撒冷的最终归属问题必须由巴以双方通过直接谈判解决。
This motion of moving American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, how do you understand his decision as such?
I mean, there is a lot of things that Mr. Trump does that I really cannot understand, but he changes them. I mean, look at his ideas about
but
Mexico.
So far, he didn't change on this.
It's only
he will change.
It's only 2 weeks. It's only 2 weeks, and the whole world is against him. I mean, 14 out of the 15 members in the Security Council were against what he did, giving away Jerusalem to Israel as the capital of Israel, when the United Nations at the beginning wanted it an international city and then wanted it to be divided into East Jerusalem for the Palestinians and West Jerusalem for the Israelis. That's what everybody in the world accepts. Everybody accepts that this will not be done except when the Palestinians and the Israelis reach an agreement. because Jerusalem is so important, not only for the Israelis and the Palestinians, but for the Muslims and the Christians and the Jews of all the whole world.
But to be fair, I would say that this decision of moving, or this attempt of moving American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, it has nothing to do with the East Jerusalem or West Jerusalem. What if he's attempted to move the American embassy to the West Jerusalem?
It's not a question of moving the embassy. The moving of the embassy, you could do it by an administrative decision. He said, I am recognizing Jerusalem to be the capital of the state of Israel, and therefore I will move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. So it's not a question of moving the embassy. It's his saying to the world that I decide that all of Jerusalem will be the capital of the state of Israel, and the Palestinians are not in my calculation.
So in your long-term goal, I mean, the sovereignty and have the capital in the East Jerusalem, which one is more important?
No. The important thing is we reach a real two-state solution. That is, a Palestinian state, we already accepted it to be on the border of 1967, not in the border of 1948, not even in the border of the partition agreement. The partition agreement gives us 44% of Palestine. The West Bank and Gaza is only 22% of Palestine.
By the war of 1967, East Jerusalem was already acquired by Israel.
All of the West Bank and Gaza was acquired by Israel by a military conquest, which the Security Council considered illegal. I mean, all international agreements consider Israel's occupation of East Jerusalem, the West Bank, and Gaza as an illegal occupation made by force against the will of the people of this land. And therefore, up till this minute, no country in the world accepts that the West Bank and Gaza, including East Jerusalem, is part of Israel. West Bank and Gaza is still an Israeli colony supported by the America, but not recognized as becoming a part of Israel. It is still occupied territory. East Jerusalem remains to all countries in the world as occupied territory.
耶路撒冷是巴以冲突中不得不提到的争议之地。作为宗教圣地，这里被誉为三大一神宗教的圣城。在东耶路撒冷地区，犹太教的哭墙和圣殿山，穆斯林的圆顶清真寺和阿克萨清真寺，以及基督徒的圣母教堂都坐落于此。
中东问题的一个根源就是巴以冲突，而巴以冲突的一个关键争议点就是耶路撒冷的归属问题。在耶路撒冷，对于大部分沙米特一神三教来说，那些最重要的圣山、圣殿、圣堂都是在东耶路撒冷。而东耶路撒冷直到1967年以前都是属于约旦的辖区，也是直到今天巴勒斯坦人民依然心心念念要回去建国的地方。In the two-state solution plan, is a capital in the East Jerusalem a must?
In the plan, Jerusalem is a reflection of the total situation. If you want a two-state solution, you have to have two capitals in Jerusalem.And the logical border would be the border of East and West Jerusalem. But that border has to be negotiated. Okay? He violated that by saying, I don't care about a border. I don't care about everything. I don't even call it West Jerusalem. I'm saying that, you know why he said he's saying that, if you recall his speech? He said, because in Jerusalem, there is the
Knesset, the Supreme Court, the government. Yes.
Yeah, but these are not all in West Jerusalem. They're also part of East Jerusalem. The Israelis have taken a lot of the parts of East Jerusalem that did not even belong to them before 1967. So the question really is, this had to be defined. If you really want a two-state solution, you have to recognize the state of Palestine. The United States never recognized the state of Palestine. The United States still considers the PLO as the representative of the Palestinian people and still considers the PLO to be a terrorist organization. I mean, so how are you going to really make peace between two states if you already, one of them, which is the original owner of that place for the last 3,000 years, okay? And is considered a terrorist organization. And what do you want people to consider when you decide that Jerusalem will be the capital of the state of Israel? Decide on your own. Who are you? I mean, the Americans are doing the same mistake as the British with the Balfour Declaration. Who is the government of Britain to decide?
在漫长的巴以和谈进程中，犹太人定居点问题一直是一大羁绊。1967年第三次中东战争后，以色列军事占领了包括约旦河西岸和加沙地带在内的大片阿拉伯土地，并在此后开始实施修建犹太人定居点政策。几十年内，定居点数量与规模不断攀升。时至今日，约有58万犹太人生活在东耶路撒冷和约旦河西岸的120余个定居点中，其中绝大多数定居点越过了巴以1967年边界线，这被巴勒斯坦人认为是对本国领土的侵占，由此也引发了巴以之间的数次战火硝烟。哈马斯在过去的10余年内向以色列发射了数千枚火箭弹，而以色列也多次对巴勒斯坦控制地区进行大规模军事打击。而回到谈判桌上，两国虽先后在美国等第三方的调停下签订过奥斯陆协议、希伯伦协议等多份文书，但论其执行也都未得其果。本期节目嘉宾沙阿斯作为巴勒斯坦首位外交部长，参与了一系列的历史事件，其中就包括奥斯陆协议的起草和签署。
As a foreign minister of Palestine, you participated in a lot of negotiations with Israel, with America. Well, let me ask you a bold question. Do you really believe negotiations is a way lead to peace?
Well, we went actually back into Palestine by a negotiated settlement, which was called the Oslo Agreement, which was signed in the White House. And therefore, we had really a dedication to reach an agreement. We wanted to reach an agreement. We struggled using armed struggle for a long time, between 1965 and 1982. But in 1982, we lost our last post on the borders of Palestine. We started in Jordan, and then there was problems with Jordan. We went to Syria. There were problems in Syria. And then in Lebanon, our forces were evacuated after an 88 Israeli siege, 88 days siege of, so there was no more possibility to conduct armed struggle.
But you know, what we see from outside world is you keep talking and negotiating with Israel on the settlements, but meanwhile, for decades long, they keep building the settlements. So does it really work?
Look, the Israeli plan is not a typical colonial plan. It's what we call a settler colonial plan. And it is a settler colonial plan with an apartheid system built into it. They wanted to make out of Palestine a Jewish state, not a state for all its people, but only a Jewish state, which is similar, by the way, to a white state in South Africa. And South Africa is a model for us in more ways than one. So in 1969, I wrote 3 articles that became very famous about us and South Africa becoming a model of one democratic state with no apartheid, in which Jews, Christians, and Muslims can live together in one country. And this article was translated into lots of languages and became actually eventually adopted by the PLO as the objective of the struggle, that we are struggling today to create the Palestine of tomorrow, and the Palestine of tomorrow will be a state for Jews, Christians, and Muslims in a democracy.
So you are talking about one state solution.
Exactly. That was in 1969. There was no two state.
巴以之间，一国方案与两国方案的起源还要从贝尔福宣言说起。1917年，英国政府发表了赞同和认可犹太人在巴勒斯坦建立一个犹太人之家的贝尔福宣言。最初，英国希望在巴勒斯坦地区建立一个融合犹太人与阿拉伯人的统一国家，但阿尤人民冲突不断，该计划最终搁浅。1947年，英国宣布了从巴勒斯坦撤出的愿望。此时的巴勒斯坦地区已有约60万犹太移民。同年，在英美等国的主导下，联合国通过了181号决议，规定在1948年结束英国的委任统治后，将巴勒斯坦地区分为两个国家，犹太人和阿拉伯人分别拥有55%和45%的土地，而耶路撒冷被置于联合国的管理之下。这一方案被阿拉伯国家联盟断然拒绝。巴勒斯坦地区阿拉伯人与犹太人随即爆发冲突，继而引发了1948年的以色列独立战争。
So you are talking about one state solution.
Exactly. That was in 1969.
Two state solution.
There was no two state solution at the time. There was an Israeli occupation of the Palestinian land, but the idea of two state came after the war of 73. And it was with a lot of encouragement from President Sadat of Egypt, actually, and King Hussein of Jordan. The idea was that if the Israelis will not accept a one state,which is a democracy like the United States or like South Africa, with many people, different religions, different colors, and so on, then we have no other alternative but to divide Palestine into two states.
Which is to go back to the plan originally before 1948.
Now, a one state solution would be on the 1948 boundary, but for all the Jews, all the Christians, all the Muslims,will be living in a democracy in which worship will be totally free, and nobody would have any problem.
Actually, before the creation of Israel, two-state solution was on the table, but rejected by the whole Arab world.
Well, the Israeli occupation of Palestine actually started in 1917 with the Balfour Declaration made by Britain. The Balfour Declaration, in effect, really,The British wanted to get rid of the Jews, so they asked them, where do you want to go? They said, in our past history, we used to be in Palestine, so on. So the Balfour Declaration was given by Britain before it even occupied Palestine. I mean, like 1917, we were 94% of Palestine, were Arab Palestinians, Christians and Muslims. And the Jews were 6%. And despite that, the British promised that they will turn Palestine into a Jewish state, basically a homeland for the Jews.
Well, they said that they will have their political rights on this land.
They said the Jews will have their political rights, but the non-Jews would have only religious and civil rights. They don't have political rights.
They didn't mention the political rights.
So that was in 1917. Then the British occupied Palestine a year later, and then 2 years later,After that, 2.5 years after that, they went to the United Nations, or what was called the League of Nations, and got a mandate to implement the Balfour Declaration by the British government. So in effect, between 1921 and 1948, they brought thousands of Jews from different countries, basically from Europe. Then, of course, you know, before World War II, the Germans made the Holocaust against the Jews of Germany. Actually, all the suffering of the Jews came in Europe. It did not come from Arab countries or African countries or Asian countries. All the Holocaust, all the treatment of Jews, they were treated, was done by European Christians. I mean, it was not done by any Muslim country or Arab country or Asian country or African country.In 1947, the British decided to leave Palestine, all right? And in fact, deliver it to the Jewish organizations, which are called the Zionist organizations in Palestine. So they went to the United Nations again after 1917 and suggested to divide the country into two. So this idea of dividing the country into two really only came in 1947, after 30 years of the Balfour Declaration. We could not accept it because at the time, we were still 2/3 of the population was Palestinian, and yet they gave us only 44% of the land.
So back then you couldn't accept it.
Yeah,
but now this is something you are working for.
All right.
Things changed.
Well, the balance of power changed. I mean, Israel became a major military country. They are the fourth nuclear country in the world. They have 200 nuclear bombs. They are the fifth largest air force in the world. Their per capita income today is 40 times the per capita income of the Palestinians. They are the ally of the United States, which gives them full support for their policies, whatever their policies are.
像在19世纪初，生活在巴勒斯坦，也就是现在的以色列一带的犹太人只有寥寥几千人。可是后来，随着犹太人自身经济条件的改善和当时民族主义思想运动的开展，有很多的犹太人开始希望能够返回到那片应许之地，尤其是在1917年英国的贝尔福宣言以后。巴勒斯坦人呢，直到现在也是很喜欢谈论在1948年、1967年，犹太人是如何通过战争获得土地的。可是，在建国以前呢，在1947年以前，犹太人是如何获得土地的呢
？Dr. Shaath, you have been through those years, and I always have a question. Before the creation of Israel, a lot of Jews went back to the land. However, they did acquire the land by purchasing them from the Palestinians.
They did not purchase anything in the 62% of the West Bank. They purchased...
Yes, I'm talking about the land, I mean, before 1948.
Even before. I mean, before... I'll tell you, what today is Israel, not the West Bank and Gaza, in 1948, we owned 98% of that land. Today, we own only 2% of that land. Did we sell it? No, it was taken over. Every bit of land that the Israelis occupied in 1948, they turned it into something called the enemy's property. All right? So the enemy's property was gradually transferred from the enemy's property registration to the state of Israel. So today, we don't own anything in the 1948, 2%. There are 1.5 million Palestinians in Israel who are Israeli citizens, and they are still considered second-class citizens.
Let's talk about before 1948. That's really something puzzles me. Before 1948, before the Jews went back to their land, that how did they acquire the land from the Palestinians?
The land that was acquired by purchasing was a very small part, of the land. There was land given to them by the British government because the British government was a mandated government in Palestine. So there was land that they got. They also purchased land from absentee owners. Palestine was part of the Ottoman Empire. So many of the landowners were Lebanese and Syrians who at one time were one country and then they were divided. Now these people after 48 or even the years of World War II until we got to 48, they had very little relationship with Palestine. And it was a very difficult time during the war. So they get an Arab-speaking broker who tells them, I have friends who want to buy your land, and you are far away, and there's nothing, and how much do you want? And he says, $1,000. They say, we'll give you $10,000. So, but you sign this contract. And that was the major part that was purchased was through this process. Okay, but all of that was still a very small part of the land. And all of the land they purchased was still less than 6% of the land. I mean, when Israel was created, the Jews in all of Palestine owned 6% of the land. So the rest was taken by the Israeli government, was confiscated by the Israeli government.